Well, friends, in this hour ahead, we're going to spend time worshiping our God, and we're also moving through a sermon series. And what a joy it is as we encounter these individuals who had encounters with Jesus, that we can be reminded that God longs to be in a relationship with us. I love the fact that I've got a wonderful preaching team that I get to preach alongside. Our pastoral team has been preparing alongside me for this sermon series. We're in for a treat today, but also stick around to the end of the service with some next steps on how you can get more connected in the life of this church and to be resourced in following Jesus. But right now, let's lift up our hearts and our voices in praise. May God bless you in this hour ahead.
I've ever known, I'll never know why. Well, friends, as we come today into the written word of God and the preached word of God, my prayer right now is that God will hide me behind the cross of Christ, that you will encounter the living God in the living word of God, in the life of God who sees you. My prayer right now is that this message is for you and that you experience God. We are in a sermon series called He Sees Me. Three simple words that underline one of the most profound truths we'll ever find in the Bible and in all human experience. Before we get started, let's just stop and think about this sermon series title, He Sees Me. Let's stop and think that the God of the universe, the creator of this world, sees us, knows us, each and every one of us uniquely and personally. Oh my gosh. And that it's not in some Santa Claus kind of way, keeping track of who's been naughty and who's been nice. It's in one of the most profoundly loving, humanizing ways that we will ever know. I remember when I was a brand new baby Christian, I learned a song that I just loved, and it stayed with me all this time. The song is called Only You Can Shake the Mountains. You can Google it and find it. And one of the refrains says, "With a word, you spoke the heavens into place, scattered stars and gave the earth its frame. And who is man that you should touch him with your grace? And who am I, O Lord, that you would know my name?" I can remember laying awake at night when I was a brand new Christian, being immersed in the Word of God, immersed in Christian community, beginning to be discipled. And I can remember thinking that Jesus knows me, that he knows what I care about, what I worry about, what breaks my heart, what takes me down, that Jesus knows the number of hairs on my head, and that he loves me, and he sees me when I most need to be seen. And this is true for each and every one of us. And if that doesn't bring you to your knees in gratitude, at least every now and then, let it. Let yourself know and believe that God sees you. Let this knowledge heal you from the ways of the world, the ways that this world can make us feel like an object, right? Something that's in the way, something used, forgotten, forsaken, denied. That's what this world can do to us. And that's what this sermon series is actually all about, that it's a pretty universal human experience to feel dehumanized, to feel unseen. And Jesus comes into our lives to restore our humanity. God's birthright to us, the image of God in us. May the Spirit of God indwell you and restore you and rehumanize you as you hear and take in for yourself that God sees you. In the sermon today, we're going to meet Nathaniel. Nathaniel is one of the 12 apostles of Jesus. We hear about him in the Gospel of John. Now, I'd like to title this sermon, The Undoing of a Cynic. In Isaiah 6:5, when Isaiah is having a vision of the heavenlies and he sees God, Jesus enthroned, and there's angels flying all around singing, "Holy, holy, holy," the first thing that Isaiah says is, "I am undone because my eyes have seen the Lord." You see, at this moment for Isaiah, he was caught by something, and his nature was being reversed, undone, reoriented. And so it is that we will see the same thing in Nathaniel. We will see that it's simply through Jesus telling Nathaniel that he saw him, that the cynic gives way to a brand new believer. So let's jump into the Word of God. I'm going to be reading from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, and I'm going to be starting in verse 43 and reading through to the end of the chapter. Let's listen to the Word of the Lord. John chapter 1, verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathaniel and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." And Nathaniel said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Really, Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him, Jesus said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." And Nathanael asked Jesus, "Where did you come to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under a fig tree? You will see greater things than this." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven and earth opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the word of the Lord. And if we believe it, we say out loud, "Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God." So let's start at the very beginning of John. It's a very good place to start, by the way. We just need a little bit of context for everything that is happening here in this scene with Philip, Nathanael, and Jesus. So at the very beginning of the Gospel of John, John introduces us to Jesus. He says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God." John wants us to know that this Jesus is the Messiah, a cosmic Christ, the King of Israel. And after this introduction to Jesus, he goes immediately and introduces John the Baptist. Verse 6, chapter 1, he says, "There was a man sent from God whose name was John." This is not the writer of the gospel, John. This is John the Baptist. He says, "He," John the Baptist, "came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light." And so we have Jesus and John the Baptist. And in these first few verses of chapter 1, John, the gospel writer, wants us to know that these are intertwined, Jesus and John the Baptist, that they interpret each other. John the Baptist was sent to prepare the way of the Lord. And we learn more about John the Baptist in the Gospel of John than any other of the Gospels. And so let's just take a moment to look at John the Baptist. Now, at this time in history, when Jesus came on the scene in his public ministry, John the Baptist was out in the wilderness preaching and baptizing in the River Jordan. Now, scholars believe he could have been out there anywhere from 1, 2, maybe even 2.5 years preaching what God had anointed him to preach, a baptism of repentance, of repenting from sin. Why? Because the anointed one was coming into the world. And so John is readying the people who have longed for a Messiah to get ready to repent. So John is out there in the wilderness preaching his baptism. And it's within reason to believe that Peter, James, and John, the closest apostles that Jesus called, may have directly heard John the Baptist preaching. They were in the same area. At least they heard indirectly about John the Baptist. He was creating quite a stir. Jerusalem had sent scribes and Pharisees to inquire about him to find out exactly what he was preaching and what he meant, and John did not withhold his testimony. We know that John, the gospel writer, was there. When John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world," and pointed to Jesus as he walked by. And this John says, "I was there. I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." This John, the gospel writer, witnessed the Spirit of God descend upon Jesus when he stepped into the river to be baptized and remain on him. John, the gospel writer, is giving us an eyewitness account of what happened in the wilderness with John the Baptist. This is an extraordinary thing in the context of what is happening or about to happen with Nathaniel. Why? Because all of this happening in the wilderness represents Israel's longing for a Messiah. John the Baptist had come to prepare the way for the Lord. He wasn't just out there talking about something ethereal. It was on. Get ready. And so Nathaniel, like most other Jewish men and women at this time, had a longing for the promised one. They were longing for the Messiah. They were longing for a change. They were longing for a peaceable kingdom. You see, at this time in first century Palestine, the longing for the Messiah was at a fever pitch. This was the Messiah who had been promised to Israel by Moses and in the prophets. And this longing was deep and the waiting was painful. I want to stop again here just for a moment to talk about painful waiting. Anybody else know anything about painful waiting? If you were promised a puppy when you were 4 by your parents, then you were 5 and 6 and 7 and the puppy never came, even though the puppy wasn't there, you still believed in the promise, right? I believe that you probably didn't give up on that promise of a puppy until you were 14, 15, 18, leaving the house. That promise remained unless your parents said specifically, "It's not going to happen. We changed our minds." But see, that's not how God works. God does not want us to give up on the promises that he has made in Scripture. And so the waiting can be painful. For Israel, this waiting had been at least 1,500 years. And it's even longer if you go back to what God said to the serpent in Genesis chapter 3. It's a long time of waiting and longing for the promise to be fulfilled. And we get impatient waiting in line at Starbucks, right? Of like, "Where's my macchiato? Like, come on." Israel was waiting 1,500 years at least. The Exodus out of Egypt, Moses is mentioned as one of the makers of the promise. That was in 1450 BC. That was when Moses was leading Israel out of Egypt. Isaiah's prophecies about the Messiah were spoken in around 600 BC. Zechariah's prophecies, 500 BC, Malachi's prophecies about the Messiah, 400 BC, and then silence. There was no prophet in Israel for 400 years. God just stopped speaking until John the Baptist booms onto the scene. For 1,500 years, this promise of the Messiah had been woven into the very fabric of Jewish life. It was a thread woven through the law, a thread woven through the prophets. And no one in Israel could have possibly understood the fullness of God's intentions when God had prophets and the law point to the Messiah. For most in Israel, the Messiah was the dream of a deliverer, someone like Moses who would lead them out of their current circumstances, who would overthrow their oppressor and return them to their homes. For some, it would be a military man like Joshua who could just make it happen, who wouldn't flinch in the battle. For some, maybe their dreams of the Messiah wandered toward the promise of a good king. Maybe the royal line of David, someone who would be wise like Solomon. But these people often had to catch their wanderings and remember the times that they were in, where a good king was a distant memory. Which brings us back to this time, first century Palestine, the time that Jesus walked into John the Baptist's throng of people out there in the wilderness. You see, at this time, Roman oppression was getting even worse. There was civil unrest amongst the Jews. That's why the oppression was getting worse. Injustice made the oppression worse. Taxes were getting raised and anger was running high. At this time, there were even areas in Galilee, which is out where John the Baptist was preaching and baptizing people. There were bandits, outlaws of Jewish outliers, particularly in Nazareth. These were the Robin Hoods of their time, the Robin Hoods of Israel, who would steal from the rich and give to the poor, which meant steal from the Romans and give to the Jews. It was great to root for these guys until the bandits couldn't be found and the punishment came down and made things worse on the Jews. And so we can only imagine the tangible excitement of these men when they heard their teacher, their rabbi, their prophet, John the Baptist, cry out, "That's him! That's the one! I'm not even fit to untie his shoe. That's him, the Son of God, the Lamb of God." And one of these men who heard that was Philip. Philip comes into view here now. We notice that in verse 43, which is where I began the reading, that Jesus decides to go to Galilee and he has some intentionality about finding Philip. It seems that he was looking for Philip. And why do we know that? Because it's the exact same sentence construction. Philip found Nathaniel. There was an intentionality. Philip, upon knowing that he was meant to leave John the Baptist and to start following Jesus, the first thing that Philip does is go and find his friend Nathaniel. And he says to Nathaniel, "You're not gonna believe it, dude. We have found him. We have found the one that was written about in the law, the one that the prophets proclaimed. It's him." And then you can just hear the scratching of the needle and the music stopping. You see, Nathaniel missed the headline and he went right for the byline. Nazareth. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Now you see, Nathaniel clearly has a disdain for Nazarenes. Maybe it's because this is where a lot of the outlaws were. Maybe he'd received some of the punishment that the outlaws were due. But there's something more disturbing, concerning going on here with Nathaniel than just his disdain for Nazarenes. You see, he blows off his friend. He cops an attitude. Who does this? Who has any friend that comes up and is excited and you just blow him up, shoot him down? That's what Nathaniel does to Philip, the first person that he wanted to share this news with. What is going on with Nathaniel? It seems that somewhere in all of his years, out of the 1,500 years, in his lifetime, the waiting and hoping, the years of searching scripture and believing had just gone too far. And somehow, maybe without him even realizing it, he had become a cynic. I want to drill down on that word cynic. Can any of you relate to the word cynic? By definition, A cynic is someone who is distrustful of human sincerity or integrity, or someone who is doubtful about whether something will happen. Now, I don't know about you, but I see a lot of cynics in the world today. I see a lot of us sliding down the hole of cynicism. I hear in the world and I hear in the church not that many people talking about the integrity and sincerity of human beings. The thing is, no one is born cynical, right? If you ever meet a cynical child, stop and think about the circumstances that produced that child, that cynicism. You see, the nature of a child is to hope, is to believe. That's why we love children so much. And that's why we are supposed to pour our integrity, our sincerity, our kindness into the kids of this world. And we are supposed to hold on to this nature with them, through them, for as long as we can, because this resets the cynicism of adults. At some point in time, Nathaniel had childlike faith, wonder in the Word of God, as he was meant to. And though he still gave it lip service amongst his friends, he was no longer giving it his heart. He didn't want his heart to hope again. He didn't want to take in the words that Philip was speaking to him. He wanted to shove it away, and he did. Now, this isn't the first time that we have seen someone in Scripture that's needed to not let their heart hope again, right? I would say that Sarah is amongst the first. Abraham's wife, Sarah. You know, Abraham went to her. They were already both old, well past Sarah's point of bearing a child. And Abraham, her husband, went and said, "Guess what? God says we're gonna have a baby." And she lets herself hope in this. And then the years start clicking by. And for anyone that's ever known a biological clock, we know that those years count. And we know that those years hurt. And I am with you, my sisters. I went through that pain. I know it. I know the pain of waiting. Sarah had a double dose of waiting because her husband gave her a promise that came to him for God for them. But after so many years, she realized that Abraham must have misunderstood, that this promise for him must not have been for her. And so she needed to wall up her fount of hope. She needed to close it off. She gave Abraham Hagar and said, "This promise is for you. Go make it happen." And she removed herself from the narrative. She took back her heart and her hope. Have you ever felt like walling off the hope that's inside of you? Are any of you living through a Proverbs 13:12 time right now? Are you living into the knowledge that a hope deferred makes the heart grow sick? Are any of you heart sick right now? Have any of you been through so much heartache and misfortune that you can actually imagine Job's wife saying to him, "Why do you persist in your integrity?" And integrity can also be translated as innocence. Why do you persist in this innocent faith in God? She says to him, she says, "Curse God and die." You ever had your spouse just destroy you? Job did. Man, just get jaded. Give up. Why are you doing this to yourself and all of us watching you sit in this pain? You see, something real happened to Sarah, and something real happened to Job, and something real had to have happened to Nathaniel. It's just that Scripture doesn't tell us what it was. When Philip brings Nathaniel to Jesus, Jesus says to him, "Here is a true Israelite in whom there is no deceit." And Nathaniel again is like, hang on. Have we met? Where do you know me from? And this is such an interesting moment. It's not how do you know me? It's when we like, have we met? Where do you know me from? And this Greek word for where is the word pothen, and it denotes origin. Now, it can denote the origin of place, but it also can denote the origin of a state, a source, or a cause of something. And so, between verse 48 of Nathaniel taking a step back and saying, "Where do you know me from?" and verse 49 saying, "You are my God, the King of Israel, the Messiah. You are who Philip just said you are." There is a whole world that we don't know, that no human eye saw, that only God alone and Nathaniel could have known. You see, Scripture doesn't provide any hints, and so our anointed imaginations are allowed to flood into this space. We're allowed to bring our own experiences to this space and imagine what might have happened. Now, some of you may be watching The Chosen. Some of you may have heard us talk about The Chosen. It is an anointed series that is on right now. It's been in movie theaters. There are GoFundMes. It is an amazing movement of the Holy Spirit. So if you're not watching The Chosen, go watch The Chosen. And the reason I'm bringing it up right now is that they imagined this scene between Nathaniel and Jesus. It's in season 2, episode 2. And this is how the writers, the producers, the creatives on The Chosen imagine this moment here in John chapter 1, between verse 48 and verse 49. You see, they imagine that Nathaniel on this day had suffered a vocational catastrophe, a career-ending, you'll never work in this town again kind of soul-killing incident. And it's on this day, the day of his ruin, that he goes out to the fig tree and tries to pray to God, tries to find himself, tries to find God. This scene under the fig tree, as these creative producers and writers have imagined it, has Nathaniel trying to pray the prayers of Israel, trying to come back as we might. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," but it's just no good. It's not ringing true for him. And finally, they have Nathaniel start reciting the verses of Psalm 102. And by the way, Psalm 102, a psalm of David, is subtitled "A Prayer of One Afflicted When Faint and Pleading for the Lord." These are the words of Scripture that they imagine putting into Nathaniel's moment, into his mouth in this moment under the fig tree. "Hear my prayer, O Lord. Let my cry come to you. Don't hide your face from me in the moment of my distress. Incline your ear to me. Answer me speedily when I call." And then there's just time clicking away. No answer. No nothing. And Philip literally says, "Nothing?" I'm sorry, not Philip. Nathaniel says, "Nothing?" And then it shows Nathaniel literally getting out his work and holding his work before God and saying, "You gifted me to do this work." And friends, here in Hollywood, I know what this is like for so many of us, for so many of us in so many industries, in teaching, in nursing, in being in politics. We feel that God has anointed us and gifted us and called us to a vocation, and then it doesn't happen, or it doesn't work out the way we thought it would. And so Nathaniel holds his work before God and then literally sets fire to it, and it burns. And Nathaniel takes the ashes of that and pours it over his head to complete his sorrow. Now, I don't know about you, but I've had moments like this, not sitting under a fig tree, not burning something, but I have had moments where I have cried out to God, moments that have been so very personal, so very private. I've literally gone into a closet and cried because I didn't want my dogs to hear me crying because I didn't want to upset them. These are private moments that many of us have that only God could know. And many times we feel alone in these moments as we cry out for God. You see, God then seems to find a way, somehow, somewhere, to let us know that he sees us. Jesus, in this moment, says to Nathaniel, when Nathaniel asks, "How do you know me? From where do you know me?" Jesus says, "Well, I saw you. I saw you under the fig tree. Kim, I saw you when you locked yourself in the closet. I heard you crying." Jesus says to Nathaniel, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip ever got to you." And there's something in this that catches Nathaniel, that doesn't let him go, that starts to undo the years of waiting and hoping. It starts to reclaim him. It starts to break down the cynical exterior, the barriers, the walls, and it lets the life flow in again. The Chosen imagines this scene where Nathaniel doesn't know what's happening right now, and he turns his eyes to Philip, and Jesus says, "Don't look at him. Look at me. Let's you and I see each other right now." In other words, we shouldn't turn our face away from God when God starts talking to us. We need to be open to this moment of being claimed by God, of being born again, of having life spoken into us, of receiving God saying, "I see you." You see, that's what happened for Nathaniel. In the Chosen scene, it has Jesus saying, when they're looking at each other, "I saw you. When you were in your lowest moment and you were alone, I did not turn my face away from you. I saw you." And somehow it seems that in this tangible exchange, something transpired that was life-changing for Nathaniel. It seems like all he needed to know was that he was seen and known and cared about by God. And in that moment, he doesn't even need his old vocation, his career. He is being called and birthed into something brand new. Jesus says, "I see you. I saw you. I will always have my eyes on you." So I want to ask us right now, in this world that happens between verse 48 and 49, what's in your space right here? And how will you know that God has spoken a word for you? It's a question that so many people have. How do I know the voice of God? How do I know that his word is for me? And I want to tell you, friends, you will know that you know that you know it when you hear it and you know it. It is confirmed by the Holy Spirit, and we have to break down our cynicism in order to receive it. And I have a testimony from our own congregation that I want to share with you, and I have permission to share this with you from the person that shared his testimony with me. This is about a person in our congregation, and he has cancer, a bad kind of cancer, and he's fighting for his life. He's submitted himself to chemo, and he has one of the best attitudes I've ever seen. But you can imagine, as he asks for prayer and receives prayer, that pretty much everyone in our congregation knows him and knows this circumstance about him and how it's affecting him and his family. And so many people come and say, I'm praying for you, or I want to pray for you. And we can imagine that there are also people that say, God wants you to be healed. I've got a word from you. God's going to heal you. And this very knowledgeable, very disciplined disciple of Jesus takes all of it with a grain of salt, right? So many people want to give their interpretation to these circumstances. They're well-meaning. But this congregant of ours, he receives these prayers, he receives these words, and lets them flow through him and over him. But he waits upon God. But one day there was another congregant who said, I have a word for you. Don't leave after worship. I've got to talk with you. I've got to tell you what God showed me for you. And he was like, yeah, okay, all right, yeah, sure, I'll wait. Isn't that just like us to go, okay, that moment is Nathaniel's moment of like, And yet he's a good friend to people. He waited. Now, what was unknown to the person who had this word for him was his own private prayer. What was unknown, only known to God and to this man, is how he prayed for himself. And how he prayed for himself is Hezekiah's prayer. Hezekiah, in 2 Kings 20, Hezekiah has come down with a terminal illness. And he's told, you're not going to survive. And it grieves him. And he prays to the Lord, Lord, add years to my life. And Isaiah was the prophet at this time. And Isaiah turns back to him and says, you know what? The Lord has heard your prayer, and the Lord is going to add years to your life. What? And being mortal, Hezekiah, the king, says, that's awesome. How am I going to know what will be the sign that this is going to happen? And the Lord tells Isaiah to tell him, you ever seen a sundial? You know how the hours tick by and the shadows stretch out? Well, you will see the hours back up. You're going to see the sun move backward. And that happens. Hezekiah witnesses the sun retract rather than grow longer. That was his own private prayer, an unknown prayer to anyone in this congregation. I certainly didn't know it until he shared his testimony with me. And so when this gal in our congregation went to him and she said, I have a word, and it's more of a vision. The vision that I have is of the sun moving backwards up a staircase, just retreating. And he didn't need to be convinced that this was a word for him. He didn't need to be convinced that God sees him and is with him, and God is still moving. Jesus ends this interaction with Nathaniel by saying, was this all you needed to believe? I tell you, you're going to see greater things than this. You are going to see angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. And this is an allusion to Jacob. Jacob, one of the ancestors, the patriarchs of Israel, Jacob had a dream about a ladder that connected heaven to earth and earth to heaven. And Jesus, completing the picture of not just an earthly Messiah, blowing up the boundaries of that and saying, you are going to know that this ladder of your ancestor Jacob is me. I'm the one. I can take you from here to there, and I can bring what's there here. This is a word from the Lord. And so I ask you, where are you today? Have you maybe even unknowingly become like Nathaniel? Have you grown weary from waiting and hoping? Have you needed to wall up the hope that God has placed within you? Have you given up on the sincerity and the integrity of humans, on the idea that anything good is going to happen? God has a word for you. He sees you. Don't give up your hope in Him. Or maybe today, you right now are like Nathaniel. Maybe right now there is space opening for you, your space between verse 48 and verse 49. This space is opening for you where you are ready to say, you know what? I believe you. I believe this friend's testimony. I believe the witness of John the Baptist. I believe the witness of the entire church. I believe that Jesus, you are the Son of God, my Savior. If this space is opening for you right now, step in, lean in, say yes to Jesus, who stands before you now saying, I see you. And last but not least, I want to ask, how many of you are like Philip? I almost ran right by Philip, but I'm going to stop here with Philip. You see, when Philip came and said, we've found him, the Messiah, the son of Joseph of Nazareth. And his friend just blows him off. Many of us would have said, well, then I'm just going to go tell someone else, and left Nathaniel in his cynicism. But Philip doesn't do that. Philip says simply, come and see. Come and see for yourself. How many of you and how many of us are like Philip or need to become like Philip? Investing in relationships, in friendships, in mentoring others. How many of us need to be taking in the preaching of John the Baptist, of hearing that anointing, and then going and telling someone else, come and see. We don't let their skepticism, their cynicism, their barbs toward us hit us. They just keep saying, come and see. You see, only Jesus can turn cynicism to belief, but we can invite someone. So today, whether you have been a cynical Nathaniel, whether you are right now being born again into the belief that Jesus sees you and is your Savior, or whether you want to commit to being a Philip, invite someone to come and see. Come and see this Jesus. Get to know him for yourself. May we all be anointed by the hope that springs from the undoing of this cynic. May God bless you and keep you, and make his face shine upon you and give you peace.
Well, friends, as a church family, we want to make an impact in the city of Los Angeles. And I want to invite you to something right here, right now, that you can be a part of. Now, in Los Angeles, there recently was a homeless count in 2022. And the results of that survey indicated that there are elementary age kids in homelessness, upwards of 9,000 kids. Now, LAUSD reports that sometimes that number can swell to 10 times that amount as kids are in between situations. It is a difficult reality, and there's a tangible way in which we are inviting you to partner with us to serve that demographic, and it is our Back to School Backpack Drive. This opportunity for you to be part of distributing 500 new backpacks filled with school supplies to some kids who have never had a new backpack in their life. There's two different ways in which you can be part of this. You can either come to our physical campus, pick up a brand new backpack that you can then fill and bring back to us that we will then deliver, or you can simply go to our website to belair.org/give, follow the drop-down menu, and look for Back to School Backpacks, give directly towards that, and that will resource the purchasing of supplies to go into the backpack that we can then distribute to those kids in need. Now, all the information, everything, and all the details is found at belair.org/outreach. Our goal is 500 backpacks. We would love to beat that goal. You can be a part of it and be part of the tangible hands of Jesus loving kids in this city. So pray about it. Check out belair.org/outreach And let's see what God can do through us in the season ahead. May God bless you as you give.
This may be a song that the captives can't yet see, but if we sing long enough, they might join in with us. This may be a dance that's too heavy for those chains, but if we dance long enough, all the prisons will open up. Hey! Can't bear, but if we shout long enough, all the walls might finally fall. They may need some help lifting their hands up in the air, but we know that freedom's coming, so we'll sing it all the more. We're singing. Found you. Oh, well, come home.
we continue in worship, one of the ways in which we worship God is through the gifts of our tithes and our offerings. That all that God has given to us, we in gratitude say, thank you, God. We're not going to just use these gifts for our own purposes. God, we're going to give them back to you. We want you to use this resource for your purposes. That we as a church are called to be the church at work. And that God wants to do a work in and through us. And so that's our prayer today, is that as we give of our resources, our financial resources, that we would give not just of our finances, but of our very lives. And we would say to God, God, with gratitude, would you take these things? Would you take all of me? And would you use me and these resources for your uncommon purposes? God, that you would do your work through your church, that we might be the church at work. So let's give. Let's give with joy. Let's give with gratitude. Let's give generously. And let's thank God for all that God has given to us.
Well, before we wrap up, I would love for you to commit to take a next step in some way, rather than just wait until next week to reconnect with this ministry and this broadcast. So would you subscribe to our YouTube channel if you haven't? Follow us on social media. But also, as you go to our website, in particular, if you were to go to belair.org/connect, fill out your short information there, we can begin to send you all the things that are happening in the life of our church, not just here in person in Los Angeles, but to resource you wherever you live. We want to walk this journey of faith with you. We want to hear what's going on in your life. We want to pray for you and encourage you and be a blessing in your life. So may God bless you on this day as we follow Jesus. We'll see you soon.